We ask in the precious name. Amen. So without further ado, Joe, Jerry, and Eli.
Mercy must never be. for today to help us get here set up and home to our, yeah, those things. We just want to go ahead and open up with prayer because, you know, sometimes the devil fights most of me in nervousness. No matter if I'm speaking in front of 1,500 people at our church or in front of, you know, however many here tonight, it doesn't matter. The devil's constantly trying to fight something God's trying to do. So I'm going to go ahead and open up with prayer. I am Eli, this is Joey here, my left, Jeremy, my right. We do make up Trinity. So one thing you can ask me, but that will be the service of prayer again. All right. Jesus, we thank you for this day. Thank you for what you're doing here this afternoon, Jesus. I pray that you would anoint us, Jesus, that the words that come out of our mouth would reflect you, Jesus, and what you did us. I pray that you would have the praise of your people tonight, Jesus, and that we will be in your will no matter what we do, and that the men and women, boys and girls, will be drawn to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
Got this thing figured out. Okay. Well, this next song is actually the hardest song for us to sing, but like, God's plan is actually by God's grace for us to know him when we ever sing. Yeah, I'm sorry, I should say that. But you know, a lot of young people in the West need singing harmony groups, whatever, you know, and I think right now they're made of what a lot of people trying to be like that. Well, this is our version of trying to be like that. But this is actually a great song, and I mean, how many people know, again, that without the ultimate cross that Jesus died on, our blood, his blood can be shed for our sins, so we have eternal life in heaven.
Thank you.
Listen. I can't sit here and be quiet when God's in my vision. I don't know about me, but I just can't sit still. We thank you for using us as a vessel of your grace, Jesus, for what you're going to do here tonight. I pray, Jesus, that one person who's so close to totally giving their life to Jesus, that they feel convicted by Jesus, that the draw of the Holy Spirit would come upon them by Jesus, that they know that this is the time. They've been prepared themselves, that they're going left and right there. The one thing is, Jesus, you're the way. You're the only way. But Jesus, I pray, if one heart can be touched by Jesus, that you would do it tonight. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, welcome to God's name. I'm really grateful for the cross, for what it represented, for the price that he paid. He went through so much, more than anybody, any mind can fathom. And it wasn't that he wanted to. He questioned God. If you read the Bible in the garden, he said, God, why am I going to do this? But he said, not my will, but your will. He said, if I had to. And every time he looked down, and he, you know, the whole time, his eye was like a flint. He did not leave the cross when he was in the garden. He had his eye totally on the cross because he saw me, he saw you, he saw all of you. So, if it had not been, Ben starts on, if it had not been for Jesus, if it had not been for the over the cross, I don't know where I'd be.
Good find, one willing to Thank you. said, "Congregation, you are this one. My name is up there, 20 years old. I've been saved since I was 13. I really, really wanted to say, my old church is called Everybody Fellowship. You know, I've been a married man for 5 years now. I've seen the crazy team with Joey and Jeremy, not only drunk, or not only but he's been drunk. People look at us up here and think, man, you know, wow, it must be pretty cool if you have an easy life, you know, and maybe not say that. But I come from a single parent home. My mom was in the paper, she's got a hospital. She's done a great job with family. I'm so thankful for the love and support that she's given me throughout the years of singing and actually showing God in my life and putting Him there and putting Him first in my life. I appreciate that so much, but because without that, I mean, and nowadays in time we have no leaders, there's no hope for people anymore. There's no hope for us young people to worship God at this age, as rather than look at the old people being there, they're about to do it. It's our time to stand now and to think of what they left for us to, you know, bring salvation in Jesus and revival to the next generation. So I was saved when I was 13. Actually, the group was an accident. I played basketball with Jeremy and John School in the fourth grade together. And we all got to see, and back in the day, it was like Mike was a cool guy. He was like, "What's his name?" Yeah, he's like, anyway, we were messing around, and my family had pulled back on singing, but I never knew I could do it. And they had the same with their grandpa, and he had a group of his own. And I came over one day, "You want to go to a cookout?" And I said, "Sure." And so we were in the concert area, and this corner song. So I was sitting there, and they started singing. I'm like, "Man, this is cool, I wish I could do it." And I started singing, and all of a sudden, I'm like, "Oh my gosh, it's Lynn." I'm looking at him, "What's the call?" He said, "Harmony." I said, "Okay, anyway," and then they used to go over from there. We've been together 4 years now, and it's gone by so fast. I mean, Joey's gone from year to year, and I've gone from year to year. But anyway, I just want to be thankful for the opportunity to be here tonight and to worship with you guys. This song is actually a song that is being sang in the Passion Play that we're doing this year. It's called Passion Get Out, and yeah, they're possibly to get a chance to come down. And they get a youth trip out there. It's gonna be awesome. We'll reach over 25,000 people the first year, and then we're expecting more than this year, but this is actually a song I get the privilege of singing when God was raised in this Passion Play.
Yeah. You can hear the band. This is another great worship song. It's you guys have heard of the Catinas. Have you guys heard of the Catinas? They pop around here. Did they ever come here?
No.
Ohio?
Yeah.
They did?
Yeah.
They did? When they come, do you call them? Yeah. This is off their album. It's another great worship song. How many of you have heard of the album?
Thank you.
We love it. It's great. I know that I'm really, really not going to be here. The Lord brought through some trials as a little kid. I was born with a problem and they didn't think I was going to live. So I'm standing here walking on top of a miracle by God. We love it. We love these guys like my brothers. We love his family. For me, as a brother.
It's okay if you
mess up
because you're
eating. We're thankful to have our family here. So we're traveling with us from West Virginia. Others are family. We're thankful to have Harper Winston just got saved. We love what we do. I'm not doing it to get up here and impress anybody. We're here because God is blessed. And he's given us the ability to honor him. And this is the way we do it. Pastor Bill getting ready to come up here and get an altar call. And this song that we're going to sing is after the rock. And that's what we got to do, is surrender everything to him and walk the way God has told us to in his word. And I'm really thankful for that.
Tonight, I want to take my opportunity. Actually, they were done. I think they're going to do one more song. Is that right?
Yeah.
One more song. And this whole thing has been set up. Tonight, this was, we wanted to evangelize, we wanted to minister the word. And I knew that when these guys were coming, they were going to come with the word as far as music and ministry and testimonies. And tonight, I have no idea to see anyone's heart in here except my own. You can bear fruit as a Christian, and you can show fruit, and that's good, and that'll show that, you know, you're saved, love God, and you're doing things for God. There's some people that want to hide that. You know, they don't want to bear fruit for God. Talk about John 15, you know, that for those of us who don't bear fruit, we're like the dry and withered branch. We'll be cut off and thrown into the fire. And I used to minister in music myself, and what I used to tell people is there's two guarantees in life. You're either going to go to heaven or you're going to go to hell and die. And those are two guarantees that I will tell you tonight. Whatever state that you're in right now, there's two guarantees. You're going to go to heaven or you're going to go to hell and die. And the way to the Father is through Jesus Christ, the Son. If you listen to their songs tonight, Mercy Came Running in the song sheet, I Shall Wear a Crown, the old rugged cross. And when they sing that song, man, my spirit just leaves tonight. Because if it wasn't for the old rugged cross, where would I be? And I can relate, you know, to Eli growing up in a single-parent home. My parents divorced when I was in, I think, a sophomore, junior in high school. I turned to a life of drinking, a life of smoking pot and getting high. And I hated God, and I told God that. I said, I hate you, I'll nothing to ever do with you again in my life. And you know, through prayers, through people praying, through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, God infiltrated my heart, and God changed me. Today I'm a youth pastor in a church, and I love this job, and I love this life that I have, living for God. I want to read something, if I could, out of the book of Jeremiah. And I've been sharing quite a bit with my youth group, so put up with me, if you can, let's just right here. But it says in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 11, it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come to me and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And I will be found with you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I banished you, declares the Lord. And will bring you back to this place from which I carried you into exile." Tonight, I know they ministered earlier, you know, they said a lot of people today have no hope, they have no future. And you know, when I think about the cross that stays at the very cross that hang in our church, especially this time around Easter time, I guess I've become more sentimental. I call it Resurrection Sunday, not Easter Sunday. And to me, that's a personal conviction, because resurrection means that my Christ died for me, and he laid in the grave for 3 days, well, his body laid in the grave for 3 days. But as his spirit went through the depths of hell, he fought Satan with the keys of death, hell, and life, you know, that Satan could no longer have hold of us, that we have life and we have liberty through Jesus Christ, and we have freedom. And this time of the year is so great to me, because I know that even throughout the rest of the year I remember this, but this time of the year especially, you know, they're getting ready to do a play regarding the life of Christ, and from a child to a man who was brought into the ministry, who's died. The thing tonight that you need to remember, and again, I don't know where your spiritual status is. You know, I meet a lot of people, adults, young people. When I used to go on the road and sing, I used to meet a lot of people. They raised their hands, and they prayed, and they sang the songs, but inside they were empty. They didn't know Jesus. They were doing the acts. They were the whitewashed tombs. They were the religious people that Jesus talked about. They didn't know God in a relationship. They knew him religiously. And I'm not saying that that's their fault, but what I am saying is they needed to come from a relation, from a religion into a relationship. And the thing about Jeremiah that it talks about, he says in this verse, he says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord." This verse has been on my heart, gosh, for 6 months probably now, because it tells me that God gives me hope when I come to him. He doesn't abandon me. He doesn't leave me lost. He doesn't leave me alongside of him. You know, he's like the Good Samaritan that reaches down when I'm in the depths.
of safety where fear and this devil and Satan and the world can't come at me. Because he protects me. He's my strong power. It talks about the book of Psalms that God is like a strong and mighty tower. You know, and who can defeat him? Who can come against him and win? No man can. But tonight, what they mentioned earlier, they said, a lot of people, they seem like they have no hope in life. And I want to tell you tonight that there is one hope that you do have, and that hope is Jesus Christ. That hope to know him personally, not as a relationship, but to know Christ as a person. Just like these guys came in tonight, first time I've ever met him in my life. But I met them, and that's the way Jesus wants to do tonight. He doesn't want you to live by a list of rules, a list of standards, and a list of things that are going to draw you away from him. He wants you to live a life that the Word speaks about, a Word that gives you life, a Word that gives you hope, a Word that gives you something to live for when you wake up. And just like David, when he prayed, and I love the book of Psalm, because David says, when I was in the miry clay, when I was down and low in my life, in the depths, he took me and he put me upon a rock. He put me upon a rock. You know, and that's providing safety, it's providing salvation, that's coming to deliver us in our time of need, in our time of trouble. And that's something that's so awesome about God, because when I talk about my life real quick, when I said that I grew up in a family that was a single-parent home, you know, there was two choices I had to make in my life. The choice was, I grew up in a church. I grew up in an Assembly of God church where this is now for 21, 22, 23 years. And I knew the Word of God. I knew the Word of God. I knew if I died, I was going to hell. I knew that. But because I was hurt, because I was lonely, because I didn't have a future, I thought I didn't have a future, because I didn't have anything to live for, because my parents hated each other, I thought I was to blame. I thought I had caused the divorce. So I started drinking. I followed my dad's footsteps. My dad's an alcoholic, and I prayed for his salvation. But I started drinking. I started smoking dope. You know, having premarital sex with other women. All women. But that was enough. And you see, that's what sin does to you. That's what no hope does to you. That's what a life without Christ does to you. You're fed to the world. And just like Daniel and the lions, if God would have been with me, those lions would have devoured him. And that's what the world does, because it says in the book of the Bible that Satan is a roaring lion, seeking whom he can devour. He's looking for people who are not spiritually aware. He's looking for people who are on a teeter-totter of life, and that's where I was, actually. I was on a teeter-totter of life, ready to give my life to Christ, ready to go to the world. And when you know, something comes in from the enemy, tempted me, and I gave in to temptation. And I fell. And I fell hard. And I knew that if I would die, I would go to hell. And that's scary, folks. That is very scary. I knew that. I lived each day in fear. I would pray that I went to bed. You know, God heard me not. I went down. But God, don't take my life. I'm afraid to die. But yeah, I was too stubborn to give in to God. And I know there's a lot of young people here tonight. I want to speak to you just for a moment. God has hope for you. God has a plan for you. He has a plan for your life. When you surrender your heart to him, he opens that heart and it starts to fill with love and peace and joy and happiness and just whatever it needs to get you on a right relationship with him. But he will also put a plan in your life. He will put a seed in your heart that will make your life worth living. He won't let you stay here hopeless. He won't let you stay here without a reason. God's not like that. God's bigger than that. God loves you. God does want to give you a hope. God does want to give you a future. God does have plans for your life. The next thing that verse goes on to say, call out my name, I will hear from heaven and I will answer you. You see, tonight, God desires the people to call out to him. You know, one of the guys said that it's our turn as a young generation to take the reins and to start being the spiritual leaders in this generation. I believe that. I believe that. We've got a good path that's been plowed before us, and we need to walk in that path and make it even more capable for people to come behind us. But tonight, there's two guarantees, like I said earlier in life, that you have. You die, you go to heaven. You die, you go to hell. And that may be a little one, and that may be something that you don't want to hear tonight. And I hope that those of you who don't know Christ, or if you're in a position in life where you're losing ground, or you're giving up on God, I urge you to listen to the words that are being sung tonight, the words that you're speaking, and the Word of God tonight. That God loves you. He desires you. You think about Easter, and I know a lot of churches, and our churches as well, will do this. And we'll portray the cross. You know, if it wasn't for the old Roman cross, you know, what that cross symbolizes, wish to offer each of us. And in your own heart, you need to come to a point, place in your life where you say, I need Christ as my Savior tonight. I need to make a decision. Or maybe you're at a place in your life where you need to recommit your heart to God. You haven't been walking that path as you should. You haven't been pleasing God. You've been pleasing the world. The book of Matthew says you can serve with one master. You can't have two gods. You either serve God or you serve mammon. And if you're serving mammon, you're not serving God. And the life of Christ is not in you. And that's what the book says in 1 John. So you need to make up your mind tonight. Do you serve God or do you serve the world? But God is beckoning you in your heart tonight to come to a point and place in your life where you realize that you need Him as a Savior, where you realize that you need to make your life right with Christ. Tonight, if you would close your eyes and bow your head, I want to do it this way. And I'm just going to ask a simple question, two questions tonight, basically two different groups of people that I feel that are here. One, I feel that there's a group of people here that know Christ or have known Christ. Their walk is weak and they need strengthening of their walk. And it's basically a prayer of recommitment. If there's anybody here tonight that feels that way, just raise your hand. Let me just see that. Thank you. Anybody else tonight, you can put your hand down. Anybody here tonight for the first time that has never asked Jesus to come into their heart, but you know tonight. And I think the thing about this is that I always used to ask people is if you would die tonight, I don't mean to scare anybody. And you stood before God, why would He let you in heaven? Ask Him that question. After I asked, why should I let you in heaven? Is it because of all the good works or because you went to church? No, that's not going to get you there. Knowing Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, that's your access to heaven tonight. All those other things come after that. Tonight, if you've never made a decision or you want to make a decision to know Jesus as your Savior, just raise your hand up real quick. Is everybody in here that would say, yes, I need to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior tonight? Okay. I'm going to go ahead and pray, and I'm going to have you guys come back and do one more song. But we had a hand go up for a recommitment for a salvation tonight, and I thank God for that. As it says, the angels in heaven rejoice when one comes to know the Lord with one. You know, make that decision. And we're going to rejoice with them tonight. Because our God is too good, amen? To be trampled on by the world, to be trampled on by the devil, to have Satan come in and steal our joy and steal our victory tonight, amen? We live a life of freedom. We live a life of happiness in Christ. We live a life of peace. You know, one more thought. If you can't find that in your life tonight, I just pray for you as well tonight. That God will just infiltrate your heart with peace and joy tonight. Because, man, serving God is a blast. Problems may come and problems may go. But if you're set up on the rock of Jesus Christ, it's not going to roll. That rock doesn't roll, you know what I mean? That rock stands still, and that rock is a firm foundation. Father, tonight we come to you in the name of Jesus, Lord. And I thank you, God, for that hand that was raised. And I ask right now, Holy Spirit, that you would infiltrate their heart. And that God, you would fill their heart with your presence, Lord Jesus. That the overwhelming power of the Holy Spirit would just take control of that heart, Lord God. And Lord Jesus, you would burn, my Father God, your love in that heart tonight, Lord Jesus. And Father, through the days and months and years to come, Father, daily, that you would reassure that heart, Lord God, that salvation, Lord Jesus, is the best way. That Father, getting to know you in a personal relationship is the most awesome thing. And Father, I pray for those tonight who need peace in their life, God. They may be going through the storms of life right now. And Father, it seems like it's about to overtake them. And God, I know that, Lord Jesus, when we stand firm upon you, Lord Father God, it may seem that we're overtaken. But God, you say in 1 Corinthians 10:13 that you're not going to let anything overtake us that we're not able to handle again. But Father God, we have a way out, and that's through you. And we thank you for that promise tonight, Lord Jesus, that we have you. We ask it in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Well, let's do this. We're going to sing one more song, I guess. One more. I want to thank Pastor Bill again for having us here. Thank you very much. What's gone on in his life, the things he's faced with. But like you understand,
a group that's small. I've been where you are before. Sometimes, you know, you feel like you fall your way right back in the same place that you were. I know that, you know, no matter how big you are, maybe you're ready to jump to the altar right now, but, you know, there's only a few people here. This person might see you. You know, if it holds you back, I understand that. Well, you know, we have another chance tomorrow, right? Tomorrow in the church, so pray we'll stay there in the morning, and Jesus will come and show himself evident in the service. Just thank you again for having us here, and we'll hope to see you guys tomorrow night. Thank you. Gilly has something to say.
Okay. This last song, we, our brothers and dad, Debbie and our family, 6 months ago today, we sang at their wedding in West Virginia. And so we,
shower me with the love that I long for.
Give him one more hand.